screen the book of John, chapter 19, verses 31 through 34. And it reads, "Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jewish leaders did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water." If you give me a few minutes, I'd like to preach this message titled, "Blood and Water." You may be seated in the presence of God. Blood and water. Since the beginning of time, there have been two things that have been consistent. Blood and water. The very first miracle that Jesus performed was turning water into wine. The very last miracle he performed before the resurrection was restoring a man's ear who had been cut off by a sword. Blood and water. Anytime you suffer a traumatic injury and they take you to the hospital, they're typically going to give you two things. They're either going to give you blood or they're going to give you water by an IV. When a baby is born, there's two things for sure that you are going to see. Blood and water. I watched my wife give birth vaginally. I watched her give birth by C-section. It does not matter the method, you are going to see blood and water. And you know, the crazy thing is, they say that blood is thicker than water. And that is true. But Jesus lets us know early on that it's not just about the blood. See, we as people, we refer to our family, man, that's my blood. Like when I tell people I got a brother, they like, "Is that your like blood brother?" I tell them I got a cousin, like, "Is that your cousin or is that your blood cousin?" But Jesus lets us know it's not just about family, it's not just about blood. The Bible tells a story about how Jesus was talking to a crowd, and the Bible says that his mother and his brothers was outside waiting to speak with him. Jesus kept going, kept talking to the crowd, and finally a man said, "Hey, Jesus, like, your mother and your brothers, they're like outside waiting to speak to me." And Jesus said, "Who is my mother?" No, he said, "Who are my brothers?" He looked at the crowd. He said, "This is my mother and my brothers." He said, "Only those who do the will of God, that's who my mother, my sister, and my brother is." It's Resurrection Sunday, so today a lot of people are going to be talking about the blood. And rightfully so, because without the blood, we wouldn't be able to live again. Without the blood, there would be no redemptive power. Without the blood. But God stopped by to remind me, tell him, don't forget about the water. See, you have to have blood and water to live physically, to survive mentally, and survive spiritually. Without blood and water, you will not survive. It's balance. The cross is just a symbol of balance. No, that's all the cross is. It's just a symbol of balance. The blood that Jesus shed, that balanced this thing out. It balanced this thing out. It wiped the slate clean, because Lord knows we couldn't overcome sin. So blood, what it did was it evened the playing field, because now it don't matter where you're from. Don't matter if I wasn't God's chosen person, originally his chosen people. Don't matter where you're from. It don't matter what you do. It don't matter what you look like. The blood wiped the slate clean, a fresh new start. But now what? That's where water comes into play. Because, see, blood, it brings balance. But it's the water that's going to tip the scale. God says, "I cut the grass." He said, "Y'all had it looking like a forest." He says, "Y'all had it look like a jungle." He says, "I resurrected from the dead." He said, "I did the impossible. I did what y'all thought was hard." He says, "I cut the grass." He said, "I did the hard part." He says, "Then why are you not watering it?" He says, "Why are you not tending to it?" See, I know this is not your traditional resurrection Easter message. Trust me, I want it to be. I had a whole nother message in my mind. I was going to talk about how God was the risen King, victorious. Had new merch coming out. I'm talking about I had them pastel colors. I'm going to hit them with a little bit of this lavender. this mint green. Keenan, you in clothing? You know, I was going to hit him with that Easter pink. And God says red and blue. And me and God kind of got into it because for a minute I turned into juice off Tupac. Tupac off juice, actually. This is how I was looking the whole time God was giving me this message. I'm like, God, you giving me like red and blue. I'm like, this is not 4th of July. He said, this is not 4th of July, but this is whether my people, they live or they going to die. He says, don't you know that life and death is in the power of tongue? Don't you know that you have the ability to either speak life or speak death? And he says, if you're not going to speak what I say, then you might as well get out the way. And I'm like, excuse me? No, God, you ain't talking. But that's how God deals with me. That's how God really talks to me. So then when my wife asked weeks ago, she said, hey, so what are we doing for resurrection? What are we doing for Easter? I didn't want to tell her blood and water. I just run it all together. Blood and water. She said, what? Blood and water. What? I said, blood and water. She said, like the TV show? Poulang and Fig. She said, like that. So that's when she got up here last service. I don't know if y'all realize. She got up here and she said, she invited everybody out to the Resurrection Project. And she said, it's just going to be different. That's all she could say. It's just going to be different. But this text in John, it hits different because he's not telling you what he heard. He's telling you what he saw. John 19, 31 through 34. It says, as the soldiers came, they broke the legs of the first man. Then it says they broke the legs of the second man. It says, but when they came to Jesus, they found that he was already dead. So they didn't break his legs. It says, instead, one of the soldiers, it pierced him in the side. And it says, with that, it brought on a sudden flow of blood and water. So you have to understand that crucifixion back in the day, it was a common thing. It was a common thing to crucify people. And they broke the people's legs because what it did, it sped up their death. They broke the legs because it sped up their death. But the Bible says that since Jesus had already died, they left his legs unbroken and then they pierced his side. They pierced his side. It lets me know that people are always going to come at you sideways. No, people are always going to come at you sideways, but you can't allow it for you to start operating blindly. What I call blindly is that's called a blind side. By definition, a blind side is a direction in which a person has a poor view, typically approaching danger. We as people, we have a poor view. No, we have a poor view. That's why side chicks are glorified. People outside the marriage, people outside the relationship. Everybody want to be outside. But the thing is, it's dangerous because a lot of people don't think straight. So if a lot of people don't think straight, then how can they be straightforward? The Bible says, so a man thinketh he is. If you cannot think straight, then how do you expect people to be straightforward? But I thank God the Bible says that he goes before us and he makes the crooked path straight. And see, those paths is not just a physical place. It's also a crooked mentality, a crooked mindset, because people are twisted. No, it's some sick people in this world. People are twisted. The Bible says that the soldiers, they twisted thorns and they sat it on Jesus' heads. They made a crown of thorns. People are twisted. They come sideways, side chicks, sneaky links. Do you know the first time that I heard sneaky links? A dude at the job was telling me, he said, man, I got a sneaky link. I thought he was talking about a new hot link sandwich. Because it was around lunchtime. I thought he was talking about a hot link sandwich. I say, sneaky link, man, that sounds good. He's smiling. I'm like, yeah, boy, he got that sneaky link. So I went and Googled it. I said, sneaky link. I was like, he's talking about another sandwich. No, he's talking about a different sandwich. But I sat at the desk, and I really thought about the term sneaky link. And I said, man, that's how the enemy move. No, the enemy, he sneaks around. We're supposed to be made in the image and likeness of God, but we don't move nothing like him. Supposed to be made in his image and likeness, but we don't move nothing like him. Matthew 7 and 16 says, you will know them by their fruit. You will know them by their fruit. That means we're supposed to be living by the fruit of the Spirit, but a lot of times we display rotten fruit. We display rotten fruit. We display half-bitten fruit. We be looking like the Apple logo, but God says, do you want to be made whole? Do you want to be made whole? Jesus says, whoever believes in me, he says, whoever believes in me, he said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. I know you might be in a dry place right now. I know you might be in a dry season, but is there evidence of living water? No, is there evidence of living water? See, people post whatever on social media. They post whatever on social media. They say whatever on social media. But when I look at the evidence, does it line up? Or does it suggest otherwise? I love talking to my brother because he's a lawyer, so he always gives me that perspective. I be telling him, man, they saying this. He said, boy, don't get caught up in public opinion. I say, what you mean? He says, don't get caught up in public opinion. He said, what does the evidence show? What does the evidence show? He says, because based off the evidence, you can determine what took place. He said, based off the evidence, you can determine what took place. So it's no different when it comes to the things of God. Based on the evidence, I should be able to determine if there's water here. Based off the evidence, I should be able to determine if there's water here. That's why people try so hard to disprove the resurrection. No, people try hard to disprove the resurrection because they know that if Jesus does not die, and if he does not raise from the dead, then everything that a believer talks about is fake. All of it's a sham, it's fake. So the first thing they try to do is discredit the witness. Discredit the witness. They try to assassinate the character. My brother said, he said, that's the oldest trick in the book. So now when I hear, don't you know that the Bible is written by man? He says, they say, don't you know that the Bible is written by man? I said, I don't care if it's written by the Easter Bunny. No, I don't care if it's written by the Easter Bunny. The Bible says that all scripture is inspired by God. That word inspired means God breathed. God breathed. And then if you look at that word God breathed, it's not just about exchanging air in and out of your lungs. The breath of God, when you look in the Bible, is deeper than that. The breath of God relates to God's spirit. And anytime you see God's spirit, then it's symbolic of water. It's symbolic of water. And water is the very thing that we as people need to survive. I believe that's why Jesus told the devil, hey, a man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Don't you know that Jesus is blood and water? No, I'm not making that up. Jesus is blood and water. Put it on the screen, 1 John 5 and 6. 1 John 5 and 6 says this. It says, this is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it's the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. The Bible, from beginning to ending, points to one person and one person only, and that's Jesus Christ, blood and water. The book of Revelation, the book that people like to avoid. Now, people don't want to read the book of Revelation. There's a lot of little creepy stuff and there's scary stuff in the mark of the beast. 666, beast with seven heads. People try to stay away from that book right there. But don't let your hearts be troubled, because Revelation 12 and 11 says this. It says, and they overcame him. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Don't you know our testimony is water? No, our testimony is water. It's what tips the scale. The Bible tells a story about a woman at a well. And if you continue to read the story, it said many went on to believe in Jesus because of her testimony. All because she went and told what Jesus had done. John 4, 39, 41 is the story. It says this. It says many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. She says, he told me everything I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. Now, mind you, Samaritans didn't even fool with Jews. No, Jews and Samaritans, they didn't even get along. So for Samaritans to believe in a Jew based off of what a woman said, that's why it's so important to share your testimony. It's people that don't even fool with the church. It's people that don't fool with Jesus. They won't know parts of them. But because of your testimony, they're going to start to believe. And then your testimony is backed by his word. It's followed by his word. John 4 and 42 says, they said to the woman, we no longer believe just because of what you said. Now, we don't no longer believe just because of what you said. They said, but now we have heard for ourselves. We know that this man is really the Savior of the world. I don't want you to just take my word from me, but I want you to go hear the word for yourself. Many believe because she simply told what Jesus had done for her. What Jesus had done for her. They were related. They say, wait a minute, I know her. No, I know him. They know you, but now let them see what God can do through you. Bible says that they poked a hole through Jesus. They broke his skin, and all of a sudden, flowing blood and water. The enemy will always try to break you in order to speed up the process. No, the enemy will always try to break you in order to speed up the process. The devil tempted Jesus and took him all kind of peaks, told him you can have this. What he was trying to do was speed him up in order that he may break. I love sports, so when I watch football, they send a blitz. In football, they send a blitz. In basketball, they press you. Why? Because it's all designed to speed you up, because most people break under pressure. But God is so strategic. The Bible says that he's the potter and we're the clay. So what he does is he molds us. He shapes us. He presses us himself. How he sees fit, so we will be able to withstand. That's why the scripture Ephesians 6:11 makes sense when it says put on all the armor of God, so that you will be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. What is the strategies of the devil? He runs the triangle offense: steal, kill, and destroy. It's as simple as that. The devil is always going to try to match up with God. If it's God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, he says, well, I'm going to steal. He says, I'm going to kill, and I'm going to destroy. In other words, the devil's strategy is to break you. The devil's strategy is to break you. We all reach a breaking point. No, in life, we all reach a breaking point. You're either going to break, you're either going to bend, or you're going to stand firm. The Bible says, do not conform to the patterns of this world. Do not conform to the patterns of this world. See, a lot of people are celebrating bending. I didn't break. So they're celebrating bending, but they don't understand if you stay bent out of shape for too long, then eventually you will break. Don't let outside forces speed you up and get you out of character. Don't let them speed you up and get you out of character. The Bible tells a story about the man at the pool of Bethesda, a gate called Beautiful. The man almost got out of character because Jesus is walking by. He asked the man. Now you have to understand, the pool of Bethesda, there was a lot of lame, there was a lot of sick people there. Every once in a while, the pool would be stirred, and the first person to get in would be healed. So he's laying there, and Jesus walks up to him and says, do you want to be made whole? The man gets out of character. He don't even answer Jesus' question. He just starts complaining, talking about there's nobody to pick me up and put me in the pool. Every time I'm on my way, somebody else runs before me and gets into the pool. The thing about it was, he was partially right because he recognized that I need to get into the water. But what he failed to realize is that blood and water was standing right in front of him. God says, do you want to be made whole? He doesn't do partial because he specializes in wholeness. He realizes that he needs water. He just is looking at the wrong source. He realizes he needs water, but he's just looking at the wrong source. Most people are thirsty in this world. Most people are thirsty in this world, but they go to the wrong source. They go after blue check marks and then wonder why they're missing the mark. Chasing after a blue check mark, wondering why they're missing the mark, trying to be verified. But it does you no good to be verified if you live in a lie. It does you no good to be verified if you live in a lie. The Bible says, what is the profit of man to gain the whole world, yet lose his soul? You want to be verified, but you can't forget that the blood has already justified you. It's not about being verified, it's about being justified. Jesus was healing on the Sabbath. He told the man, he heals him, he told him, pick up your mat and walk. Pick up your mat and walk. And as the man is walking with his mat, the Jewish leaders, they approach him and say, it's the Sabbath, what are you doing carrying that mat? Now this is a man who hadn't walked in years. And instead of them wondering about how is he walking, this is a blessing. This is a miracle. They say, why are you carrying that mat? Why are you carrying that mat? You have to understand that some people are not concerned about you. They're concerned about what you carry. Some people are not concerned about you. They're concerned about what you carry. But I thank God that Jesus is concerned about you. They were breaking people's legs to speed up the process of death. But I realized the things of God, they can't be rushed. The things of God can't be rushed. I believe that's why Jesus took his time going to Lazarus. The sisters came. They said, our brother is dead. Can you come on? The Bible says that Jesus made a couple of more stops. And then he headed to where Lazarus was. You can't speed up God's timing. The Bible says that Jesus dies before they get a chance to break his legs. He's already dead before they get a chance to break his legs, which lets me know that God's timing is perfect. God's timing is perfect. You have to understand, the Roman soldiers, they were used to breaking legs, but when they got to Jesus, they were used to breaking legs, but when they got to Jesus, see, they're breaking legs, but he's breaking cycles. No, they're breaking legs, but he's breaking cycles. Either way, breaking is going to occur. A breaking point is going to happen. You just have to make sure you're breaking the right things. We're all going to reach a breaking point. You just have to make sure you're breaking the right things. Jesus always breaks the cycle. No, like literally, he always breaks the cycle. That's the story of the woman with the issue of blood. Bible says that she was on her cycle for years. They put her outside the city gate, say, you unclean, you can't come up in here. But the Bible says that when she heard Jesus was coming, she took a risk. She said, I'm going inside the city gates. The Bible says that she pushed her way through the crowd. She didn't let the crowd slow her down. She pushed her way through the crowd. And the Bible says that she touched the hem of his garment, not even his clothes, just the hem, the little dangly thing at the end. She touched the hem of his garment. And the Bible says that Jesus stopped where he was and said, who touched me? His disciples were with him. They're like, man, we're in a crowd of 1,000 people. Everybody brushing up against, what you talking about? He says, no, I felt somebody touch me. He says, why? Because I felt virtue. I felt power leave from me. Bible says that the woman got scared. She stood up and said, I did it. And he looked at her and said, woman, your faith has made you whole. Jesus always breaks the cycle, always was going against the religious leaders and the Pharisees. He always breaks the cycle. They were always talking about the law says this, the law says that, the law says this, putting the law above people. Anytime you put the law above people, anytime you put the law above people, there is an issue there. But Jesus breaks the cycle. And because they could never contain Jesus, they could never quite figure him out, they could never put him in a box, they decided to kill him. He breaks the cycle. Jesus breaks the cycle when people can't. Jesus breaks the cycle when people can't. The man who was possessed by a legion of demons, Bible says that he lived in a graveyard and was cutting himself night and day. People weren't trying to help him. Instead, they said, man, let's just chain him up. But the Bible says that he broke the chains time after time. Because the issue was that he was not chained physically. He was chained spiritually. So when Jesus steps off the boat, the Bible says that the man who was possessed by thousands of demons came running to him. He still had enough sense, enough fight in him, and threw himself at Jesus' feet. Bible says the demons started talking because they already knew what time it was. They said, Jesus, what you want with us? They said, they begged Jesus, at least let us go into the pig. Jesus said, okay, that's cool. He let them go into the pigs, and then he ran them off a cliff and drowned them in water. Jesus always breaks the cycle, and then he breaks the curse of sin. This is the one. My young people are like, no, that's the one. This is the one. He breaks the curse of sin because, truth be told, God looked and said, man, they cannot get it right. They can't get it right. She keep jacking this thing up. He keep jacking this thing up. They cannot get it right. So God himself even reaches a breaking point where he has to make a decision. Because you have to understand, back in the day, the wages of sin is death. That means if you sin, then you deserve death. So God says, either I'm going to have to kill them all, or I'm going to have to do something else. So he sends his son Jesus. He sends his son Jesus, and Jesus breaks the curse of sin. We all reach a breaking point, and Jesus is in the earth and doing exactly what his dad tells him to do. And anytime you reach a breaking point, you're always going to see either blood or water. You're always going to see either blood or water when you reach a breaking point. When Moses had to go tell Pharaoh to let my people go, lo and behold, there is the Red Sea. You're always either going to see blood or water. So Jesus gets to the Garden of Gethsemane. And the Bible says that he is exhausted. And I believe that Jesus almost thought that that was his breaking point in the Garden of Gethsemane. Because he saw blood and water. The Bible says that he was sweating blood. And he asked God, he says, if it be your will, He says, if it be your will, let this cup pass. That's why I always tell people that Jesus didn't want to die. People acting like Jesus just skipped willy-nilly to the cross. No, Jesus didn't want to die. He was human. He felt exactly what we felt. He says, God, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. Then he says, nevertheless, let your will be done. He realized that is not his breaking point, and he gets up and he gets onto the cross. And I was reading and I was studying, researching when Jesus was on the cross, and the Bible says that they stretched him so wide that they dislocated both of his shoulders. And I thought about that. Dislocation is not broken, because the scripture says not one bone was broken. So he was just dislocated. He wasn't broken. See, a lot of us feel we are too broken to be used by God. That we're too broken to be used by God. But the truth is, God says you're not broken, you're just dislocated. You're not broken, you're just dislocated. And if you know how to locate it, what's it? Blood and water. What's it? It's Jesus. When you know how to locate it, God will withhold no good thing from you. I'm going to withhold some bad things, but I won't withhold any good thing from you. I told you earlier that the wages of sin is death. That means every time you sin, you deserve death. I'm such a visual person, so every time I sin, what I visualize is that God steps up off the throne and is ready to kill me. But the Bible says that Jesus is sitting at the right hand of God. So every time I sin, every time I make a mistake, all my flaws, my shortcomings, my impurities, my imperfections, every time I sin, God stands up ready to kill me. But Jesus steps in and say, nah, Pops, I got that covered. Remember, I died for that. Yeah, I know she did that. I know she continues to do that. I know she continues to struggle with that. But now, Pops, you can have a seat. Because I died for that. I covered that. So you have to understand that the blood covers. The blood covers and the water hovers. The blood covers and the water hovers. That's why in the beginning of the Bible, it says that God's spirit was on the face. It was hovering over the deep water. Because the water, the spirit, it searches the deep things of God. I love that scripture where it says that no ear has heard, no eyes have seen what God has in store for the ones that love him. And most people just stop right there. They just, because it's good. They'll preach that and then they just stop right there. It just sounds good. No ears have heard, no eyes have seen what God has in store for the ones that love him. But if you read a little further, it says, but the Spirit makes it known. The Spirit makes it known because the Spirit searches the deep things of God. Blood and water show us two important aspects of God's death. It shows us two important aspects of Jesus' death. First of all, the blood is redemptive, but the water is life imparting. So the blood takes away sin. The blood takes away sin, but the water then gives life. The blood takes away sin, but then the water gives life. That's why I tell people when people get saved, you got to get in the water. You got to get in the water. Because getting saved is not simply enough. You saved now what? Because you can still experience hell right here on earth. People get saved all the time and then go right back to doing what they were doing. Because they were covered by the blood. They confessed. They believed in their heart. They confessed it with their mouth that Jesus died for their sins. They were covered by the blood. But then they missed the water. The Bible says that when Jesus died, he hung his head, and the Bible says that he yielded up the ghost. That means he gave up the water. That's why it says, in the last days, I'm going to pour out my spirit. Your sons and your daughters, they shall prophesy. It's good to shout about the blood, dance about the blood, but don't miss the water. Jesus dies on the cross. He dies on the cross. And y'all know the story, but in 3 days, he rose. And he didn't just rise any type of way. He rose with all power. That's why I don't just let anybody tell me anything. I got a homeboys, they be telling me, man, you need to read this book about the 48 laws of power. I said, I don't care about 48 laws of power. I just need to know that he died and he rose with all power. Then he gets out. And I love Jesus because Jesus really be talking like that. Jesus said, nobody take my life. No, Jesus said, no man take my life. He says, but I lay it down. He says, if I lay it down, can I not pick it back up again? Salvation. You cannot lose salvation. You cannot lose salvation. But what happens is a lot of people lay it down and they never pick it back up. A lot of people lay it down, they never pick it back up. I close with this. He says, "Very truly I say unto you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless you are born of water and you are born of spirit." You are born of water if you are born of spirit. It's blood and water. It's Jesus Christ. It's the name that's above every name. It's the name that demons tremble at. Bible says that at that name, every knee shall bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is not only Lord, but that he's the Savior of the world. Our testimony is water. We survive by the blood of the Lamb and the words of our testimony. That's why I'm so transparent. My family, they know. They know they're probably going to be in every sermon. Because I don't have to tell somebody else's testimony. I can tell my own. Because who the Son sets free. Who the Son sets free is truly free indeed. A lot of y'all know my testimony. Y'all know I love shoes, Jordans to be specific. And I never forget when I was in college. My senior year at SFA down there in Nacogdoches, Texas, wanting to take my own life. Was literally about to graduate in a month. I did everything that they told me to do. Graduate from high school, go to college, graduate in 4 years. I was doing all that and about to graduate with my bachelor's degree in a month. A month before my graduation, wanted to take my own life. And I never forget just going in my closet. Had a walk-in closet. And I remember just looking at all them shoe boxes. Nike and Jordan logos. And it was that moment I realized that Jumpman can't do nothing for you when you want to play hangman in real life. And I didn't grow up in no church. I was the kid who went on Mother's Day, Easter, Christmas. And I didn't want to go then. But I'm so glad that Jesus came to see about me. I remember walking out of that walk-in closet, and I had one gospel CD at the time that I had stole from my cousin. And it's crazy because the CD, now that I realized, it was blue. And it was Kirk Franklin called Hero. And I just put it in. I looked at the number, and I think one of the songs said, "Return to your first love," or "First Love," and I just pressed play. And that song just began to minister to me. Never paid attention in church, never read no Bible, but I remember hearing clear as day that day. He said, "I got plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you a hope. Plans to give you a future." And from that day forward, I tell anybody, I didn't get saved in a church. I got saved in my college apartment. But from that day forward, I never looked back. And I promised God that every chance that I get, I would testify of his goodness.